Good evening. I want the Whitakers to come get ready to sing for us as they're coming. Do me a favor. Take out your cell phone this evening and everybody check it. Every single person check it. We've yet to have a service without multiple cell phones ringing. Everybody check your cell phone and make sure that thing is turned to silent. And we will survive for 2.5 hours without taking that urgent phone call or getting the updated scores or whatever it is you do on your phone. All right, Whitaker's going to sing a song for us, and then we'll sing something together. Let's stand together, turn to page 18 in your hymn book. The words will be on the screen if you want to use that instead of the book. Page 18, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. We just sang a verse of it in a men's prayer room a minute ago. And now let's sing it all together. Sing it like you mean it tonight. All Hail the Power. Page 18.
Oh,
Amen. It's good singing. And Daniel, how about coming up here? I want you to open in prayer, if you would, please, sir. This is my brother-in-law, Daniel. He pastors out in Romulus, Hope Baptist Church in Romulus. And him and several of his people are here this evening. If you came with Daniel, raise your hand. She's already got the wave going. Thank you for being here. We sure do appreciate you driving out to be a part of it. I have so enjoyed the local churches that have been a part of the meeting this year. The preachings that some of these men have brought has just been very, very good. I'm so thankful for that. I spent time this afternoon thanking the Lord for the relationship he's allowed us to have with some of our local churches. And I look forward to expanding that and using them more often in the future. And Daniel, why don't you ask the blessing on the service this evening, please, sir?
Amen. Let's pray. Thank you, God, for, Lord, giving us the liberty to meet tonight. We're not in some third world country, Lord, where we're limited and, Lord, hiding in huts and homes, Lord, and basements, Lord, but we're able to meet freely, and we thank you, God, for that freedom. Lord, I pray that every heart in here would be open to what the leading of the Spirit, Lord. I know that it's been a long week. People are working all day long and coming, staying late, hearing preaching, Lord, and it's a blessing. Our flesh is tired, Lord, and we have one more night. And I pray, Lord, that we be open and susceptible to your leading. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Dan. You may be seated. Ryan Gunther preached this morning. That is Daniel's older brother that was preaching this morning. And he was talking, he talked this morning while he was preaching about his memories of being at Grace during fellowship meeting and the banjo and everything sitting over here. And then this afternoon he sent me a picture. It's a black and white picture. I don't know what year it would have been, but it had Mr. Whitaker sitting on the bench over here playing his banjo, and then somebody gets another banjo next to him, and Brother Walt Shell was in the choir back over here. He looked like a young man whenever that picture was taken, and I was picking out some of the faces in the choir, bringing back some good memories. Pastor Story used to tell stories about those meetings. And anyway, it was good to have Brother Ryan with us. Brother Daniel Jordan is going to be our first preacher this evening. Where are you at, Daniel? Come on up. He'll be our first preacher tonight. And this Faith Baptist Church loves Brother Jordan. He's been a help to us. I was away. I don't know where I was. I think I just had surgery, and I asked him to come fill in for me for a few services last year, a year before, and just the Lord used him in a great way in our church, and we were so thankful to be able to call him friends. And I was hoping his family could be with us this week, but Brother Jordan said he was counting it a vacation from his family. I don't understand all of that, but anyway, Brother Jordan's going to come preach for us. Would you come give us 25 minutes, okay?
25?
Yes, sir.
Well, you changed up on me. That's good. Amen. 25, yeah, I need that math done for me, so. Deuteronomy chapter number 6 tonight. Stopwatch. Amen. I want to say thank you to this church. I know people sometimes may seem like that's customary that we get up here and do that, but you don't know who I am, and you make me feel special. And I've eaten almost all of that food in those baskets. Last night I ate, well, I think, 7 cookies in the bed. And so that was good. And are these names of these roads out here? What's this, Kamba? What is it? Is that Indian? What is that?
German?
German? Who? Gotcha. All right. So, well, I was coming in yesterday, and just everything seemed to go wrong. Seemed like they gave me a purple car to rent down at the airport. It's weird. It's out of the parking lot. You'll see it. And then I came across the interstate here, and I took my first right quick, and I was going down the on ramp, going back, here's my coming up the ramp. And it was, I thought it was church people, and I was going in my purple car. And I don't know who it was that turned around. They stopped. They stayed at the top of the ramp. I thought, they're going to wait. And I come up here and look at me, you know. And, so they eventually went on, and that was crazy. But I found out why they named that road that, because as soon as I went down that road, there was some German man, evidently, up there at the top of the ramp, said, come back, come back, come back. I was like, yeah, I need to get back on come back road. That's what he was saying, come back. So we got here, and amen. Amen. We're going to try to pray. Let's pray. Lord, thank you, dear God, for these people. Thank you for this church. God, we pray somehow, some way, dear God, that you created me a clean heart and a clean mind. God, I need your help and I need your touch. And Lord, your people need your help and your touch, dear God. There's people coming here tonight, dear God, that, Lord, that are empty in areas of their life, Lord, that are facing situations, dear God, they have no answers to. God, there's things going on, dear Lord, they have no idea how everything's going to work out. God, and I pray, Lord, you help those people tonight. God, and I pray, Lord, from the youngest child to the oldest person, Lord, that we'd be helped from you. We understand, God, that we can't do anything in our own selves. God, we know that. And we need your help and we need your touch in a special way, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen. Amen. Deuteronomy chapter number 6. Amen. Verse number 6 says, "And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children." And here it is, church. "And shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, when thou walkest by the way, when thou liest down, when thou risest up. Thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thine hand, and they shall be frontless between thine eyes." And he tells them, I want you to talk about it. He says, talk to them. Verse 20 says, "And when thy son asketh thee, in time to come, what mean these testimonies and statutes and judgments which the Lord God hath commanded you? Then thou shalt say unto thy son," here he is talking again. He's going to tell his son what great works God did for them, bringing them out of Egypt. It begins to tell them, we were Pharaoh's bondmen in Egypt, and the Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand. And the Lord showed signs and wonders, great and sore, upon Egypt and upon Pharaoh and upon all his household before our eyes. And he begins to tell him all of these things that God has done. And he's talking to the generation that's coming up under them and to their sons and daughters in their house, wherever they're at on the farm, they're talking about how God did great things and how he give us commandments and what great works he hath done in times of old. Psalm 78 says this right here. Says, "Give ear, O my people, to my law, and incline your ears to the words of my mouth, and I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings of old, which we have heard and known, and our fathers have told us." We will not hide them from their children, showing the generation to come the praises of the Lord and his strength and his wonderful works that he hath done. For he hath established a testimony in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel, and he commanded all our fathers that they should make them known to their children, that the generation to come might know them. Even the children that should come should be born, who should arise and declare them to their children, that they might set their hope in God and not forget the works of God, but keep his commandments. Psalmist even says right over across the page there in Psalm 77 and verse 11, he says, "I will remember the works of the Lord. Surely I will remember thy wonders of old." He says, "I will meditate also of all thy work and talk of thy doings." You don't have to turn there, but he says in 1 Chronicles 16:9, he says, "Sing unto them, sing psalms unto him, talk ye of all his wondrous works." Over and over and over again, the psalmist in the Bible tells us we're to talk about the things that God has done for us. God, and why? Because we have little ears listening. They need to know what God has done in our lives, so they might carry that on. In our text tonight in Deuteronomy chapter number 6, he literally is basically begins to tell them the story of how God brought them out of Egypt. Amen. And you know what a story actually is? It is actually a verbal narration or recital of a series of facts or incidents. That's factual things, you know. We have little books for children, you know, Bible stories or stories in the Bible. And stories are okay to tell. Now, I'm not all about, understand me here, okay? I understand. We're not about storytelling. But you know what? I want to be careful, too, not to discredit the word, because he tells me to talk about all his wonders and his works that he hath done. And it is okay to tell stories about the Lord. And the things that he's done, that's all right. Oh, songwriter said, tell me the story of Jesus. Right on my heart, every word. Tell me the story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard. Okay, tell me the story of Jesus. Preach upon this thought tonight on Once Upon a Time. That's what he did. He said, set your children down. And once upon a time, if I could say it that way. Because there's just something about telling a story that creates something deep down inside the listener. Yeah. Oh, yeah. To want. It's just natural. God put it there. It's just natural for you. When you begin to hear somebody tell you something about how God did in their life, yeah, something deep down inside of you longs for that to happen to you too. There's something that's powerful about it and something that God uses. And he does use that. And there's two men on the Emmaus Road. I mean, Jesus, he goes way back in the scriptures. He just begins to tell them stories over and over and over and accounts over and over and over that was talked about him. And they said, did not our heart burn within us? Why, he spoke to us, by the way. They said, sure, that something inside them burned and yearned for that. There's just something about talking about what God has done, talking about his power. The psalmist says we're to talk about his power. He did not say for us to talk and to tell the generations to come the things that God allowed us to accomplish. The things over and over in our Bible. It's literally telling us to talk about what he's done for me. And what he's done for us. He likes it. He likes it. He likes it. I promise you, get by yourself and just start telling yourself about the wonders and what God's done, the good things that I promise you, he'll show up and listen, and he already knows. He is attracted to that kind of stuff. He is attracted to that. And oh my goodness, when those kids begin to hear about what God's done for you. Yeah, come on. Oh yeah. So, there's just something about telling a story. It stirs a person's heart. It stirs his thoughts. It stirs his desires. You could tell me a story about fishing, and I want to go fishing. I don't even know anything about fishing, but you tell me about a story about fishing, and I tell you, I can imagine myself right then catching the biggest fish out there. Amen. Come on. So you're shallow. Probably am, but that's all right. Amen. You can talk about doing anything. I want to do it with you. It don't matter. And deep down inside of you, deep down inside of your meek and quiet spirit, you're the same way. You should watch Karate Kid. Danielson. Man, I tell you what, him doing that move. Yeah. Y'all know it. The little ones don't, but up here and up probably do. I used to go out of my mailbox by the highway. Cars coming by. I'd get on top of that post. I promise. I was there when it happened. I guess I ought to know. I'm telling you, I did. I watched Karate Kid, and the first thing I do, go outside, and I just thought I could just whip everything. Yeah. It's messing with me. What it was doing is messing with me. I don't know why Mama let us watch Rocky, but we did. Boy, it was on then, but if me and my brothers ever watched Rocky, it was over. We all was Rocky. Yeah. We just wanted to do what we saw, what we heard. It just influenced us. It just did. It just did. There's something natural about that. My last name's Jordan, but it has nothing to do with number 23. But I can watch basketball, and I just think I can fly. That's right. I can even feel it. That's right. We just have those shoes with the tongue. You pump them up. Boy, leopard lady there said, I got some of them. I thought it worked. I thought it worked. You play some ball? Yeah, hold on, man. Coming in. Hey, I promise y'all this is true. We used to watch that. We didn't watch it, but somehow, some way it was on TV. Mary Poppins. Look at that leper lady's woman. Here goes an altar sister. We'd go out there and get on the top of the barn. With that big old umbrella, my mama had a big Virginia Slims umbrella. You know what Virginia Slims are, don't you? Oh, yeah. Virginia 100s. We on top of the barn, and I promise you, 12 feet. Whoa. Had a flake off when it dried. Sorry if it spit on. Hey. And that umbrella would go. I like it doesn't work. And it has to work. We did it over and over again. Never did work. Came to the conclusion, they misled us. That's the truth. We just was influenced. Oh, was influenced by it. Tell me the story of Jesus. Listen here. In our Bible, he said, tells him the story about, he said, tell them about how I brought you. Tell your kids, set them down. Tell them about how I brought you out of Egypt. One of the things you need to be able to do is when you tell your children, there needs to be a time in your life that you set your children down and you tell them how God brought you out of Egypt. Oh, yeah. You need to tell them how God saved you. They need to hear that. My daddy told me not too long ago. And he offered his testimony before. He said, Daniel, he said, God convicted my heart on that tractor out there in the field. So all I knew to do was get off that tractor. And I got out there and I knelt down beside that tractor tire. And I prayed, I said, God, if you'll just let me get to church in the morning, I'll get saved. And he said, Daniel, I prayed beside that tractor tire. And he said, the next morning, they had invitation time. I straight to the altar and God saved me. He said, I don't know if something ever happens to me, Daniel, one day. He said, it'll be all right with me if you'll just roll a tractor tire down there by my casket and tell all my lost family if they'd like to come down here and get beside that tractor tire. Woo! And get to know the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I like that story, Daddy. That was a good one. It is a true one, too. Tell them how God saved you. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, I was a 13-year-old boy. Everything was fine until the Holy Ghost said, you're lost. Yeah. Ooh, yeah. Atmosphere changed in my soul.
Amen. Come on.
All of a sudden, I was the one that was going to hell. Yeah. And all I knew to do that night was fall in the arms of Jesus. That's all I knew to do. I went down to the altar. They prayed with me. I repeated the prayer. I didn't care if I had to stand on my head, do anything I needed to do. It didn't matter to me. But really, you know what? All I really did in my spirit, I just fell in the arms of Jesus. I said, Every time somebody gets saved during that youth meeting, they have a lighthouse outside in the yard, and they turn that lighthouse on every time somebody gets saved. And I've seen that lighthouse on many times. Fonz, Levi, he's got a nickname. He's the Fonz, okay, Fonzie. Listen, all right. That night, we went outside that tent. It was a tent meeting. We went outside that tent. They had no lighthouse on. It seemed like every time that beam come around, it'd go across my face, and it would say, saved. It'd go all the way around. It'd go, saved. It would go, saved, saved. And I want to tell you, it's been years and years and years and years ago, however long it is, and it's still saying saved.
Amen.
Amen. Tell them, he said, don't you? And you ever heard people say, you tell them something and they don't believe you and they go, hush your mouth. Blah. I was telling you something. Get out of here. I just got here. I get done telling them something. You'll know this one, brother. And they'll say, well, I'll be John Brown. Well, who's that? You can Google that, and it's a real thing. I'll be John Brown. I'm like, are you cussing at me or something? Is that like a hint? My mom will say, hush your mouth, boy. I'm like, I'm for real, mama. That's what happened. Can you imagine a kid? They sit their kids down and say, I'm going to tell you something, boy. God was going to bring us out of Egypt. Said this. He wouldn't let us go. So you know what happened? What God did? He had a... had a rod. Moses had a rod. Cast that thing down on the ground. Become a serpent. Get out of here, Daddy. You talk to me like that, boy. What happened, Daddy? Well, their magicians made some too. Well, I'll be John Brown. You know what our rod, Moses' rod, it ate up all the other ones. Yep. Get out of here. Yeah. Our God, Daddy. Oh, yes, our God. How'd you like to lay down beside that rod at night? Oh, yeah. Anybody with a stick in their hand always would scare you, especially if you was riding a bicycle. Yeah. You didn't go ride by the boy that had the stick. He goes, sticking them spokes, over the handlebars you go. Oh, yeah. They were scared of that rod, too. They were scared of that stick, too. Yeah, funny. Moses was meeting quiet, but he had a little side to him there. He'd open up a can of whiptail, too, wouldn't he? Wouldn't he not? He saw the old meek and quiet Moses, you know. Here he goes. Two Egyptians. He just laid the whammy on them, didn't he? Covered some dirt. Don't you move? They're scared of him, you know. Yeah. Oh, yeah. So you remember a story about Cain? Oh, yeah. Put a mark on him. Yeah. Said nobody wouldn't mess with him. If I was Cain, you know what I'd have done. Nobody's going to mess with me because they're scared something's going to happen. I would love to be that person because I would just walk around like, knowing they ain't going to do nothing. Well, my whole crowd scare all of them go. That's funny. That is funny. Hey, tell them how God brought out of Egypt. Cain was just thrown in there, sorry. And he said, not only that, one time God killed all their cattle, son. Daddy, what happened to y'all's cattle? Oh no, son, none of ours died. Daddy, you mean none of ours died? No, son. Son, what I'm trying to tell you, son, is the God of Israel, our God, is a mighty God. He's a wonderful God. He's the only God and the God of Israel. He is the God of all. He is the Almighty.
Amen.
Then you need to tell him about how, then you need to go ahead and tell him about how he had some victories in your life. Oh, yeah, he took him over Jordan there and Joshua and all them stones. He said, when your sons ask you, what mean these stones? He said, tell them. That means do something else. That means start talking. Start talking about what he's done. And then over there, discern 2 Kings chapter number 8, and I'm done. 2 Kings chapter number 8. You tell them about how God saved you. You tell them about victories he's given in your life. And then chapter number 2 Kings chapter number 8, the Bible says it's right here. 2 Kings 8, there's a famine in the land. People had to leave. Bible says in verse number 4, and said, and when the king talked with Gehazi, the servant of the man of God, saying, tell me, I pray thee, all the great things that Elijah hath done. Boy, you want to hear some stories. He said, tell me some things that Elisha done. Good one, because we could talk about him for a little while, tell you some great things he done. He begins to talk about Elisha and all of these things. You know what? He begins to tell him about one day how that woman, she couldn't pay her bills. And she was coming to take her children as bondmen. And her husband had died. And there was no hope. There was no money. There was no way. And she was far more than bankrupt. They were taking her children as payment. He said, Elisha told her, said, what you got in your house? I got a little bit of oil. He said, don't you go borrow a lot of vessels, pour it out. Did she do it, guys? Oh, yes, she did it. What happened? There was all king coming from another world in that living room. Said, oh, I never stopped pouring. Said, over, oh, yeah, over and over again, begins to tell him. Then he begins to tell him about that little dead boy. I said, one time, king, the little boy had died. His mama called. He called Elisha, said, come over and see my son. And Elisha went over to the house and said, he laid on top of that boy. Said his hands were his hands, his eyes were his eyes, his mouth was his mouth. Said he got all over that little dead boy. And that little dead boy come back to life. King, like, hush your mouth, Gehazi. Listen to this. 2 Kings chapter 4. And it came to pass, verse number 5, I'm sorry. And it came to pass, as he was telling the king how he had restored a dead body to life, that behold, the woman whose son he had restored to life cried to the king for her house and for her land. And Gehazi said, my lord, O king, this is the woman. And this is her son that Elijah life. Can you imagine? He's telling him a story about what God has done. Then all of a sudden, in walks the woman. Yeah. In walks the woman. Yeah. And Gehazi was like, well, what a coinkydink. I mean, that is her. There she is. There she came. That's the one. That's the one. There goes the little boy he laid on. And you know what? He had been hearing all of these stories and all of these things about what God had done. And he was so stirred. Evidently, he said, give that woman every bit of the land she had before. Restored unto her, I mean, she left a rich woman. And it's important that we tell and talk about the power of God so that our children will know my wife's uncle died with cancer. They gathered around the hospital. The young people did, and they prayed. Some 30 years ago, whatever. They gave him 6 months to live. Gathered around the hospital in the bushes. Until this day, he's cancer free. He made it. He made it. His mom died of the same cancer. My kids had never heard these stories. One day, Danielle got old enough. She got old enough to hear. Old enough. And we told her about Uncle Randall, how God had healed him. And you know what she done? She went up to Uncle Randall, during church one day. She tugged on his coattail. She had never known. She never knew what that scar was. She said, Mama told me about your miracle. Amen. Woo! Amen. They need to hear what God has done in your life.
Thank you, Brother Daniel. All right, if I get my family, come get ready to sing, if you would, please. Amen. Amen.
Leopard lady, I'm sorry. That's all I can say. In the mind of a preacher, you hear the final draft. You understand, right? Like in our heads, everything's swirling around. It goes through filter after filter after filter, and then you get the final draft. Can you imagine what is inside Brother Jordan's head before the filters? I can't fathom that. Kratzer, come this way if you would please, And this is Hannah. She has been a big part of Faith Baptist Church for the last few years. And she has a display table set up in the foyer. And I spoke a little bit about it in the prayer room for church. And I'll just ask you again, would you just block out everything else for the next few minutes and just listen to the ministry that God has called Miss Hannah to? And then as she's talking, maybe just ask the Lord to help you take on some of the burden she has for what the Lord has for her. All right, Miss Hannah, you come on.
It's good to be here tonight. It's been a wonderful week, wonderful preaching. Thank you, preachers, for just the ministry you've had to me this week. I am Hannah Kratzer, as Pastor said, and I am a Bible translator and missionary with First Bible International. I've been pursuing missions for the last 6 years. It's been right at 6 years ago that I surrendered. So it's been a dream for a while now, and now it's becoming a reality. And I'm really just so excited and so thankful for what God has done. Some of you might be new. You've heard from Brother Marowelli and Brother Ortez a little bit about First Bible. So that is the ministry that I'm with. There are 3,800 languages approximately in the world who don't have the Word of God. So that's a great need. When I started at First Bible as a summer intern, and it's been a very long summer internship, about 6 years. I started working on children's curriculum, just writing children's curriculum over different Bibleist people groups and learning more about the need for Bible translation. The Lord was burdening my heart more and more for the needs of the world, but I still felt like there is absolutely no way God could use me in something like that. And my personality is one of the ones where it's like, prove it to me. So I was reading about Bibleist people groups, but I had never met someone from a Bibleist people group, and I had never been face to face with the need. And so I was still waiting for the Lord to prove it to me. I'm a little stubborn. But in February of 2019, I got to take my first trip to India. I didn't want to go, but I went, and I was face to face with the need. I remember our first day, we were going out doing some sightseeing, and as I was spending my time with the Lord that morning, I was in Acts 17, and I read the verse that said Paul's spirit was stirred in him when he saw a city wholly given to idolatry. And I just, I'm like, that's good that Paul was stirred, put my Bible away and went about my day. And as we were driving around India, the national that we were working with was sitting behind me, and he was picking on me, I think. He would drive past the village, he'd be like, sister, that village has no Bible. Sister, that village has no church. Sister, that village has no gospel witness. Sister, that village has no Bible. I'm like, stop, Stop telling me I'm overwhelmed. And the Lord just kept bringing back that verse to my mind. Paul's spirit was stirred. And, as we were driving around India that morning, the Lord was stirring my spirit. Later that day, we went to visit in the home of an Indian family. And the husband had just had a stroke. He had young children. So they were obviously very discouraged and working through these medical issues. And the brother we were with, they were new to his congregation, so he wanted to go and encourage them in the Lord. And so he pulled out his King James Bible and started reading it to them. And I was so mad at him. Like, they don't need the King James Bible right now. They don't speak English. And so he read these verses, and he said he spoke to them in their language a little bit, and we left. I'm like, brother, why'd you do that? He's like, sister, they don't have it. It's not possible for me to encourage them from the Word of God in their language because they don't have it. And I was just so overwhelmed. I was like, that's not fair. What they need right now is the Word of God. And so I went back to the hotel that night, and I was like, Lord, you keep bringing that verse to my mind, so there must be something that you have for me. And so I flipped open my Bible, and the next verse says, therefore disputed he daily. And so I was like, okay, so Paul was stirred, he had a therefore. So then I started praying, Lord, what do you want my therefore to be? What part do you want me to have in all of this? Because I will spend the rest of my life writing this children's curriculum and raising awareness if that's what you have. But I was like, I really hope you'll let me be a Bible translator in India. And so I came home, and the Lord confirmed from his word that Bible translation was the ministry that he had for me. I surrendered to that, not really knowing what the next steps were, because the First Bible School of Translation was still in the planning stages. I didn't know how many years it would be. I didn't know how much it would cost. I'm like, well, we're just going to put the next foot forward and see what God does. And as soon as I told my pastor I'm going to be a Bible translator, he's like, wonderful, we have the school, we're starting in August of 2020. I'm like, well, I graduate Bible college in May of 2020, so that's perfect that I can just transition right into that. And so for the next year and a half, I was still studying Greek and preparing to serve the Lord in the area of Bible translation. and praying every day that God would let me spend the rest of my life in India serving him there. And I knew that the Lord would make me love wherever he called me, but I was really just praying, Lord, please let it be India. So I was here at this church in June of 2020 for their Seedline project, and we had a life-changing nacho night. You know, I've always said nachos are a life-changing food, but that night was life-changing as Pastor asked me to pray about working with the Zonka Bible Project. I wish there were pictures of what my face looked like when he asked me, because I'm sure it was just like dead. And so we went back to the hotel that night, and Brother and Mrs. Gill were there, and they were in the truck just giggling. And we got to the hotel, and I was going to walk in my room, and Brother Gill said, "Have fun not sleeping tonight." I'm like, "Thank you." And I went in the room just not really knowing what to do. And I said, "Lord, what would keep me from saying yes to him?" Because I wanted, you know, that I didn't want to say no just because I didn't want to go to Bhutan. And the Lord revealed some things to me. And one of the things was, if I say yes to this, I'm not going to get to go to India. And I had to surrender that over to the Lord. And I prayed and surrendered that, pulled out my laptop and looked up Zonka language and saw on the map that they were all over the very area of India that I had been praying to go to. And then I did some more reading and found out that Bhutan is a restricted access country, and it is nearly impossible for foreigners to live there. So in order to minister in Bhutan, I would have to live in India. And then I almost jumped from bed to bed out of excitement, but I didn't. And I went to bed and slept very well that night. And I went home and spent some time in prayer and fasting, seeking counsel, and the Lord confirmed that he would have me to be a part of the Zonka Bible Translation Project. The next month, I started my training at First Bible School of Translation. It was a very intense program, 3-year master's degree. So I've learned biblical Greek, biblical Hebrew, linguistics, translation methods and principles. And it was a long time, 3 hard years. While I was doing that, I also had the privilege to teach Greek and linguistics at our Christian school, which was such a valuable training experience for me to learn how to teach these things to others, which I know the Lord will greatly use once I'm able to move to the mission field. And so I just graduated in May. I'm very thankful for the time I had in school, but I'm maybe more thankful that it's over. To be at Fall Fellowship and not be taking midterms is definitely a blessing. And so I will start full-time deputation in January to raise my support to move to India to start working on the Zonka Bible Translation Project. Zonka is the national language of Bhutan. Bhutan's a very small country nestled between China and India. It's often overlooked in geography and even more so overlooked in our missiological efforts. So they are in desperate need of the gospel. There are about 800,000 people in that country, and it's illegal for there to be a church. So there is no established church in Bhutan. I'm thankful that I can tell you that the Lord is still working, that there are house churches there, so people are able to come together, and the Lord is still making a way for the people in Bhutan to hear the gospel and to respond to it. The Lord has done some wonderful things to make connections with people in the country so that we can start looking forward of how are we going to do this and who is our translation team going to be. Right now, we're not really sure on all of those details, but God is working. I'm starting to see more and more pieces to the puzzle. I don't know how they all fit together, but I just see God in the middle of all of them, just pulling them together. So that's been a joy. And thank you, Brother Jordan. I need to tell that story more often. So, but right now, the Zonka-speaking people have a Bible that was translated by a modern Bible translation company. And they hired some Buddhist men to translate the Bible for them. So those Buddhist men got together and translated the Word of God and made it a Buddhist book. The name that they use for God, so our Creator God, is the Zonka word Kensho, which is referring to the three jewels of Buddhism, which is the Dharma, the Buddha, and something else. I'm forgetting right now. I'm sorry. But something else. So it's what every Buddhist child is taught to pray to. And so what every Buddhist child is taught to pray to is the name that they're using for our Creator God. And so obviously there are great issues with that. The people of Bhutan will not use the Bible that they have. And I hate to say it, but I'm kind of thankful for that because it's translated so poorly. So they do use the English Bible when they're able to. But I just ask if you would just pray with us. There's still a lot that we don't know. We need laborers. We need wisdom. We need the logistics to work out. You know, India doesn't want me there. Bhutan doesn't want me there, but God wants me there. And so I trust he'll make a way. So thank you all for your time. And just please be in prayer for us, and more specifically for the people of Bhutan, that God will just even now work in the hearts of the people and prepare them to receive the most amazing message that we've been given. Thank you.
Thank you, Hannah. We'll be going back to India. My wife and I, my daughter Mariah and Hannah, will be going back to India in the next few weeks and to try to lay the groundwork for the translation to begin and to trying to find everything we need for Miss Hannah to live there. And so exciting weeks coming. There's a display out here in the foyer. We call it the Bhutan display or the Dzongka display. And in that display, last time I was in India, I heard the gentleman we were staying with talking about the Bible that Dzongka has and how useless it is. And a couple of years ago, our church was able to purchase some property close to the Bhutan border, just about 4 miles from the border, and in preparation for this phase of the project. And I don't like the word irony, because I believe everything is of the Lord. The property we ended up buying was a facility that was built by another translation ministry years ago that's kind of gone by the wayside, and we moved in. But in one of the garages, one of the outbuildings on that property, they found cases of this Dzongka Bible. And well, they were talking about what to do with it, and I said, can I have one of them? And they said, you can have them all if you want. We can't give them out. They're useless. And back there in the foyer, you'll see what is the Dzongka Bible right now. And it's I have a burden for that particular group. But just to think of the resources and time spent on something that is useless, it just bothers me. And so the Lord being who he is, and if he'll help us, we endeavor to make sure that the Dzongka-speaking people get a reliable word of God. I don't want a Bhutanese pastor to have to stand in front of his people and read a verse the best he can in English and then try to tell them what it's supposed to say. I think he ought to be able to read it in his heart language and be able to expound to the people the way I get to do it on Sunday mornings to the people of Faith Baptist. One of my favorite noises to hear is on Sunday mornings when I say, stand with me and take your Bibles and turn to, and all the pages turning. Now, that sound has never been heard. Never been heard in one of the Bhutanese churches. Never been heard. And I want to make sure they get to know what that's like. I want to make sure they know what it is to experience the preacher saying, turn in your Bible to, and then be able to do it. It'll be a great day. It'll be a great day. And so I would ask you again, just get with Miss Kratzer, ask her questions. And independent Baptists are awful finicky and kind of weird. No, we're a lot weird. Brother Jordan proved that a little bit ago. And in the minds of a lot of pastors, the idea of sending a 25-year-old woman to India to spend a lifetime working on the Word of God, a lot of preachers say, well, that's just not right. We'll never do that. Well, I say if a woman says she's called to go do something and shows evidence of it, I say, let's help her get there. Let's help her get there. And I don't see lines of men lined up ready to go. So I say let's use what God's given us and let's send Miss Kratzer. She'll do a fantastic job. All right, enough of that. Let's stand together. And Brother Luke or Brother Dowdy, I see you're both here. Brother Dowdy's coming. We'll sing a song. Choir, come on and find your place in the choir loft. And we're going to hear from the choir. And then after the choir comes down, we are going to receive an offering this evening. And the entire offering is going to go right to our missionaries that are here this week. There's been 5 good ministries that have been represented out here, 6 I believe it is. And whatever comes in tonight, every dime is going to be divided to go between them. And so you prepare to give in that offering in just a few minutes. What are we going to sing, Brother Dowdy? Where are you? 426. Page 426, Dwelling in Beulah Land. We'll sing one verse of it, and then we'll hear from the choir. Page 426. God. You may be seated as the choir sings this evening.
Thank you. It is not fame that I desire, nor stature in my brother's eye. I pray it said about my life that I live more to build your name than mine.
Amen. Thank you, choir. I have enjoyed and appreciated the choir all week. It's been a help to me. Let's stand together, please. Why don't you shake hands with somebody, tell someone you're happy to see them. If you need a quick restroom break, you can take that right now. The choir's going to find their seats. We'll get ready for that offering in just a moment. But tell someone you're happy to see them tonight.
Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
All right, you may be seated. I'd like to have the trio get ready to sing during the offering. I don't know where Miss Melody ran off to, but they'll find her. Ushers, come on with those offering plates. Brother Jeremiah Williams will be our next preacher. Brother Williams, if you'd make your way to the platform, please, sir. I don't know where you are, but you come on and get ready for that. Ushers, as soon as you're all ready, come on, let's get the offering this evening. As I said a while ago, every dime that comes into this offering is going to go right to our missionaries, and we'll divide it equally among them, and we'll make sure they get that before they leave. I've enjoyed hearing from the missionaries this week. We had a cottage prayer meeting in our house on Monday night before the meeting started, and we got to spend some time with some of the missionaries then, enjoyed some testimonies, and Brother Comstock had to leave early. He had another meeting he had to get to, but got to spend some time with him, and met some new people this week. So grateful for that, and the ministries that we've had here this week are worthy ministries. They're worthy of your support, and so you give tonight knowing where that's going. All right, Brother Don Burchett, would you lift your voice good and loud, please, and ask a blessing on the offering?
are covered by the blood. My sins are all covered by the blood. My iniquities so vast have been blotted out at last. My sins are all covered by the blood. Once in sin's darkest night, I was wandering alone. A stranger to mercy I stood. But the Savior came nigh when he heard my faint cry. And he put my sins under the blood. They are covered by the blood. They are covered by the blood. My sins are all covered by the blood. My iniquities so vast have been blotted out at last. My sins are all covered by the blood. From the burden I carry, now I am set free. For Jesus has lifted my load. Oh, the love and the grace I received in its place when he put my sins under the blood. I can ne'er understand why he sought even me, why his life blood on Calvary flowed. But sufficient for me since he died on the tree. He put my sins under the blood. They are covered by the blood. They are covered by the blood. My sins are all covered by the blood. My iniquities so vast have been blotted out at last. My sins are all covered by the blood. My iniquities so vast have been blotted out at last. My sins are all covered by the blood. My sins are all covered by the blood.
All right, Brother Williams, come on up here. This is Brother Jeremiah Williams. It's the first time he's ever preached for us. He's been in our meetings several times, and his wife and daughters have sung for us a few times. But I am so happy that he's with us this evening. I wasn't sure it was going to work out with your schedule. I know you got a lot going on. He's assistant pastor at Parkview Baptist Church in Livonia. Brother Steve Brown is the pastor there, and both are great men. I've enjoyed getting to know him some. We've spent quite a bit of time together over the last few years, and I count him a friend in the ministry, and we're thrilled that he's with us. Brother Jeremiah, come take us to about five after.
All right, sir. Thank you, brother. Well, it is good to be here tonight, and I appreciate your pastor. He has been a friend, and we've had a lot of... one thing I appreciate about him is when we're together, we laugh a lot, and there's some preachers I've been with I've never laughed with, and so he doesn't ask me deep theological things, which is probably good. We just have a good time, so I appreciate him, Miss Melody, and the friendship that we've had with them, and my wife wish she could be here tonight. I did bring two of my children with me. I promised them Culver's, and so they came. You got to know your audience, and my other two kids are, one of them is working, and he's in the ministry now. He's bread and chicken for Chick-fil-A, and so he's doing the Lord's work, I'm going to tell you right now. We moved up here in 2007 from South Georgia, and when we got up here, I looked around. There was nowhere to eat. There was no Chick-fil-A's. There was no barbecue places. And I thought, Lord, why? Why did you call me here? And so we've been praying. We finally got a Chick-fil-A there near the house and a place for the kids to work. So it's been a blessing. God's been blessing us. And the church is doing good, too. But that Chick-fil-A came in. Amen. Joshua chapter 6 is where we're going to find our text tonight. And if you find that, if you wouldn't mind standing with me for just a moment as we read our scriptures. And when Brother Summers, the Pastor Summers, asked me to preach, he said, bring something encouraging. I said, well, I'll try. But I hope this will be a help to you tonight. It's been a help to me as I've studied and looked at these things. Joshua chapter 6, and in verse number 1, we're going to find that the Bible says here, now Jericho was straitly shut up because of the children of Israel. None went out and none came in. And the Lord said unto Joshua, see, I have given into thine hand Jericho and the king thereof and the mighty men of valor. And you shall compass the city, all you men of war, and go round about the city once. Thus shalt thou do 6 days. And 7 priests shall bear before the ark 7 trumpets of ram's horns. And the 7th day you shall compass the city 7 times, and the priests shall blow with the trumpets. And it shall come to pass that when they make a long blast with the ram's horn, And when you hear the sound of the trumpet, all the people shall shout with a great shout, and the wall of the city shall fall down flat, and the people shall ascend up, every man straight before him. And Joshua the son of Nun called the priests and said unto them, take up the ark of the covenant, and let seven priests bear seven trumpets of ram's horns before the ark of the Lord. And he said unto the people, pass on, encompass the city, and let him that is armed pass on before the ark of the Lord. And it came to pass, when Joshua had spoken unto the people, that the seven priests bearing the seven trumpets of ram's horns passed on before the Lord, and blew with the trumpets, and the ark of the covenant of the Lord followed them. And the armed men went before the priest that blew with the trumpets, and the rearward came after the ark, the priest going on and blowing with the trumpets. And Joshua had commanded the people, saying, you shall not shout nor make any noise with your voice, neither shall any word proceed out of your mouth until the day that I bid you shout. Then shall you shout. So the ark of the Lord compassed the city, going about it once. And they came into the camp and lodged in the camp. And Joshua rose early in the morning, and the priest took up the ark of the Lord. And the seven priests, bearing seven trumpets of ram's horn before the ark of the Lord, went on continually and blew with the trumpets. And the armed men went before them, but the rearward came after the ark of the Lord, the priest going on and blowing with the trumpets. And the second day they compassed the city once and returned into the camp. So they did 6 days. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you so much for just this time that we could gather around your word. And Lord, we thank you for what's been done in this place already. Lord, we thank you for this meeting. We thank you for this church and for this pastor. It's all the need for it. But Lord, I pray you would just still our hearts for a moment. Allow us to glean something, dear God, from your word that would be a help and encouragement to us as we try to live out a life of Christianity here in this wicked, wicked world. And so, Lord, if your name is glorified and your name is honored, we would do everything that we could, dear God, to see that happen. We just pray that you'd help us tonight, dear God, and we'll thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Thank you for standing. We read all those verses to really get down to that last verse there in verse number 14. It says they compassed the city, of course, the first day and then the second day, and they returned to camp, and they did this 6 days. And of course, the seventh day we would know that these people would come and they would go around the city, and the city, the walls would fall down flat. We probably all sang that song there in junior church about walking around the city of Jericho. But as I was reading through this passage one day, God had been dealing my heart with some things. When I was a young man, a few years back, my grandfather wanted me to take flying lessons. And I was about 14, 15 years old. He sent me on a discovery flight, and it was a wonderful, wonderful thing. I enjoyed it and wanted to get into that. And actually, one of my dreams was to go into the Navy and fly fighter jets and blow up stuff and shoot things and just have a grand old time, fly off of aircraft carriers and all those kind of things. But God didn't let me do that. So he called me to be a preacher. I don't get to blow things up, except people's lives sometimes, but not on purpose. But so I started my training, and when I was 15, 16 years old, I started flying just a small Cessna and doing these things. But my flight training was in Orlando, Florida, and I don't know if any of you have ever been to Orlando, Florida. Of course, that's there's some things to do there, but the airport there is considered Class B airspace, which is a very, very busy, busy airport, and all these different things. And I remember as I was learning my flight training, they would bring us in, and sometimes they would say, we would call in and say, hey, we're ready to enter the pattern to land. And the air traffic controller would come back and give us our tail number back, and they would say, listen, we need you to go bearing 180, just continue on that, and then you're going to turn and go this way, and you're just going to keep circling the airport. And I remember sometimes I'd be looking, and I can see the airport. It's right there. Just let me land. Just let me set this thing down. And there's some, through my life, I've had to learn this one thing, to learn to wait. To learn to wait. Amen. Here we have these people of God. They come into the land. They have finally crossed over the Jordan River. They see Jericho. Jericho is right there. They are outside the city walls. And yet God is telling them to do what? March around it. Yeah. If there's one thing they learned from their parents, it was how to go in circles. They spent 40 years walking around in circles in the wilderness. They finally get into the land of promise, the land flowing with milk and honey. What does God want them to do? Walk in a circle. Just do it again.
Amen.
When are we going to stop? You know, if you read through that, I never really see where God told the children of Israel anything. He just told Joshua. And Joshua had to tell the people, this is what we're going to do. Now, I mean, if it were me, I would not be too, I wouldn't want to do that. It's right there. Let's just go conquer the city. But God said, wait. You know, sometimes I find in my life, God's going to leave me circling in the pattern until he's ready for me to land where I'm supposed to be. And so I want to give you just a few things here tonight. I hope it'll be a help to you. It's been a help to me. You know, I just crossed, I just had my birthday a couple weeks ago, September 21st, Brother Summers. Put it in your phone. I don't, whatever. And I turned 45, you know, and 45, my son is sitting back there. He comes to me on September 21st in the morning, and he says, Dad, how's it feel to be halfway to 90? And I said, get thee behind me, Satan. But, you know, 45 years old, I haven't hit a midlife crisis yet, but I am going to put a spoiler on my minivan, I think, and maybe a hood scoop or something, but... You know, when I was 20, I had a lot of different thoughts about where my life was going to be. It did not involve the ministry. God didn't call me into the ministry until I was about 21, 22 years of age. I had a different plan for my life. I had different things I was going to do. And I have learned through these last 20, 25 years as I've been at different places, different churches, how to wait. And so I want to share some things with you. The Bible tells us over in Lamentations chapter 3 and verse number 26, it is good that a man should both hope and quietly wait for the salvation of the Lord. We love that verse, but how often do we actually quietly wait? I mean, I don't wait very well anyways, but to quietly wait is not within my character makeup. I'll be honest with you. My wife, if she were here tonight, she'd be saying amen. That I do not quietly wait on anything. I want to go. I want to see it happen. You know, let's get moving. Let's roll. Come on, Lord. Why are we waiting? I can figure it out, Lord. If you give me just 10 seconds, I'll tell you exactly how it should be. And so I want to give you two things not to do and then one thing to do just here real quick about waiting. The first thing is don't get disgruntled. This is something I've had to learn because I get a little irritated when things aren't happening quickly. And I start to think, well, I could do this better than that person. When we get disgruntled, if we look at the children of Israel, they came through the wilderness, they come into the land here. One of their key components, I think, that God was always trying to battle within their lives was the critical spirit, the murmuring, the always having to question everything that was going on. And even Miriam and Aaron would question Moses, and they had to pay a price for that. But we have to be careful that when God has us in a holding pattern, when God is trying to teach us something through waiting, that we don't get critical, we don't get disgruntled in the work of God. It's very, very easy sometimes as a pastor to get a little disgruntled with how things are going at the church. Maybe you're looking at the life of a person and saying, you know, Lord, I've preached on this 36 times. When are they going to get it? Or maybe you wake up and you look in the morning and say, Lord, I know you've been speaking to me, but I think we can move on to something else. He just puts us in a holding pattern, and we cannot get disgruntled. We cannot get critical of what God is wanting to do in our life, because when we do that, we will get cynical. The people of God, when they were there in the wilderness, the book of Psalms tells us, it says, yea, they spake against God. They said, can God furnish a table in the wilderness? You know, God can give us this manna, but can he give us meat? God can give us water from the rock, but hey, you know, what are we going to do about water all the time? You know, God can bring us through the Jordan River or through the Red Sea, but how are we going to get across Jordan? I mean, all these different things. We get disgruntled in waiting on God. We get critical of what God is doing. And then we begin to get cynical, like, is God even going to do it? You know, I've been now at Parkview Baptist Church since 2007. So we just crossed 16 years going into our 17th year as an assistant pastor. I feel like I'm broken. That was a joke. Man, I didn't go over nearly. I used to say that's like a young man going to Bible college and coming away after 4 years unmarried. There's something wrong with him. Now, okay, we'll knock that one off too. See, they work at my church, but they love me, so, and they know me. They know just how weird I am. And so I'll mark those off. Don't use those any other place. But 16 years as an assistant pastor is not something that I had in my plans. There have been opportunities to go. Churches have come by and said, hey, you're weird enough for our church. Why don't you come over and see if we'll fit? And each time God has said no. When I left Brunswick, Georgia to move to Livonia, Michigan, I was not looking to go anywhere. And my dad, he's been a pastor. Ever since I can remember. I was born at Bible college, so I didn't need to go to Bible college later on because I was born there, so it worked out well. But my entire life, he's been in the ministry. And when I left Brunswick to go to Livonia, he told me this. He said, Jeremiah said, if God has called you there, he's going to have to call you away from there before you go anywhere else. And there's been numerous times I've thought, Lord, this is the time. Jericho's finally going to fall down. I'm finally going to get in the show. Be the senior pastor. And God says, no, you're just going to wait. You're going to wait. Why? Well, maybe I'm not ready. Maybe there's things in my life that still need to be figured out. But maybe it's just God has me in the place where he wants me to be. And he's told me, you know, I tell my people at the church, hey, plant where God, or grow where God's planted you. And then I'm like, Lord, when are you going to move me? Are we going to? I've had to take my own advice. And God's been working, especially in my life, over the last few months, last year or so, in this area of waiting and not being disgruntled in what God is doing. Don't get critical. Don't get cynical. Turn over with me just real quick to 1 Samuel chapter 24. I want to look at a verse here, 1 Samuel chapter 24. And, while we cannot get disgruntled with God, we also can't get detoured from the way that God is taking us. You know, there are certain things that God will do in our life that he's wanting to use to strengthen us, to grow us, to help our faith, to increase our faith. And so we cannot get detoured. Look at me in 1 Samuel chapter 24. And these verses here tell us the story of Saul and David's mercy to him there at the cave of Engedi. And we'll just kind of pick up in verse number 1. It says, it came to pass when Saul was returned from following the Philistines, it was told him, saying, behold, David's in the wilderness of Engedi. And so he goes down, he's looking for him. In verse number 3, it says, he came to a cave there, and Saul went in to cover his feet, and David and his men remained in the sides of the cave. And the men of David said unto him, behold, the day of which the Lord said unto thee, behold, I will deliver thine enemy into thine hand, that thou mayest do to him as it shall seem good unto thee. Now, what could David have done? David had been anointed the king of Israel. Amen. He could have killed Saul there and taken a shortcut to where God had already told him he was going. But that was not God's plan. Right. David would later say, I'm not going to touch God's anointing. I'm going to allow God to take me where God wants me in God's timing. We cannot try to sprint ahead when God is walking. We cannot try to run where God says, don't go. We can't say, you know, on the way over here tonight, there was everything against me trying to get out of that city. There was a wreck at the where I needed to get on the interstate. So I went to another spot to get on the interstate. There was a wreck there. So I thought, well, I'll go the back roads. There was people from Colorado driving slow. And, you know, driving from Livonia to here does not get, I'm glad I wasn't the first preacher because I was not in the spirit to preach. Because I used to never have road rage until I moved to Michigan. Now I have it all the time. But I thought, I'll take this shortcut. And then I thought, oh no, I'll do this short. And it just kept getting longer. My GPS kept saying redirecting and all these different things. And I tried to use an English lady on my, so it sounds cultured and whatnot. And I figure if I got one lady tell me what to do most of my life, I'm going to have another one tell me which way to drive. Anyways, love you, babe. She said she was going to watch me, so I knew I had to behave, and I didn't. But I thought, no, I can go this way, and I can go this way. And what am I doing? I'm trying to take a detour. I'm trying to get a shortcut, because everybody loves a good shortcut. And I was not getting any further ahead. I was falling further behind. And when we try to do that with the will of God, we will always fall further behind and get ourselves further away from God. There is no quick fix to following God's will. God works in time. It's amazing to think that God exists outside of the confines of time, and yet he works within the confines of our short little life to bring us to fruition of full faith. So we cannot try to take a detour when God is telling us to wait. You know, there'd be sometimes I'd be flying that plane in circles thinking, when can I land? And I did not know what was going on the ground. Perhaps another plane had wrecked. Maybe there was something out there on the runway that caused there to be danger for me that I could not land. I don't know what was going on. All I knew is that I had to follow the instructions of that air traffic controller to land the plane when he said land. No sooner, no later. Why? Because I would put myself in danger. I would put others in danger. Daddy, you try to get ahead of God, you're going to put your family in danger. We have to follow God's plan and God's time, and sometimes it means wait. We don't like it. We cannot think that our way is superior to God's way. There have been times in my life, especially here recently, that I have had to tell myself, listen, God is God, and you're not. God is God, and you're not. He knows what he's doing when I don't. He knows where I'm headed when I am lost. He knows what he has for me when I have no idea. He tells us over in Isaiah, my ways are not your ways, nor my thoughts your thoughts, for my ways are higher than your way, as my thoughts are higher than your thoughts. And we have to understand that God, if we will just wait on God, we will not get what is good. We will get what is best. Because God always gives his servants the best when we wait on him. So we cannot get ahead of God. We cannot think that our way is superior to God's way. And then this one thing that God is trying to help me with that I'm still working on it. I still sing that children's song, he's still working on me to make me what I ought to be, because it was easier for him to hang the sun, moon, and stars than it is for me to get me to do what he wants me to do half the time. But I've learned this one thing, defer to God. Defer to God. That word defer there means to give precedence to. 1 Peter chapter 5 tells us, likewise, you younger, submit yourselves unto the elder. Yea, all of you be subject one to another and be clothed with humility, for God resisteth the proud and giveth grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. You know, one thing I have learned is I defer to God. He orders my life in the way that he wants. Psalms tells us the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his way. Just talking to a young man one time, and he quoted that verse and said, yeah, but there's a prerequisite there, the steps of a good man. God's ordering the steps of those that will follow him and walk with him and allow him to lead them. I have to defer to God. I have to allow God to order my life. And the final act of obedience is up to me. It is up to me. I have to learn how to obey God. We love to talk about how God is going to take care of us, but what about us being in the place where God can do what he wants us to do when he wants to do it? Amen. We make so many decisions based on our comfort or our convenience instead of just obedience to God. We have an entire society of Christianity that is dealing with nothing but how convenient can I make church for me? It has nothing to do with obeying God. It has nothing to do with what does God want me to do. It has everything to do with, hey, what can God do for me, not what I can do for God. 2 Samuel chapter 22, we find this passage. It says, he brought me forth also into a large place. He delivered me because he delighted in me. The Lord rewarded me according to my righteousness. According to the cleanness of my hands hath he recompensed me. He's saying there, David is saying, hey, he delivered me because I was walking after him. He delighted in me. He rewarded me because of the righteousness I was living for him. You know, the Bible tells in Psalms chapter 37, verse number 4, delight thyself also, Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thy heart. Commit thy way unto the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. You know, and talking to my children, some of the things that I want in my life are not what God wants for me. God's not wrong. What I have to do is learn to adjust my wants to God's will. And too often we say, God, no, that's not right. That's not what I'm going to do. I know better than you. Yes, I know that you created me and that you saved me and you did all these things for me, but give me just 5 seconds, Lord, and I'll help you fix my life. When God just wants us to defer to him, to obey him, to allow him to bring order. God is not the author of confusion, the Bible tells us. He's not going to bring us into a land of confusion if we will just allow him to order our steps. He will lay it out before us. Amen. I have a 19-year-old daughter, a 17-year-old son, a 15-year-old daughter, and a 13-year-old son. And when I say those things, it makes me feel really old because now I have all teenagers in my house. But what I'm learning with them is that I'm trying to help them as they step out into life is say, listen, you don't have to know what you're going to do when you're 30. You just have to know what you're going to do today. And today you need to get up, read your Bible, pray, ask God what he wants you to do today. And when you don't know what to do, do what is right. And God will order your steps. Listen, I don't know, perhaps tonight you're waiting on a diagnosis of health or you're waiting on a job or what you're waiting on. Listen, God knows, God cares, and God will help you with it as we walk with him and as we obey him. But don't try to run ahead. Don't get deterred. Don't get disgruntled in waiting on God. Just defer to the mighty hand of God and allow the God that loved you so much that he sent his son to die for you to guide your life and bring you to the place. Hey, guess what? In the next verse, they walk around Jericho another time, and guess what happens? The walls fall down. Why? Because they walked around it 6 days prior. Thinking, what in the world? But on the seventh day, God brought him into land. And God will bring you to the place where he wants you to be if you'll wait on him. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for this time that we could gather around your word. And Lord, I pray this has been a help and encouragement to your people. Bless the remainder of our service tonight. We'll thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Jeremiah. Stand for a moment and stretch your legs. Brother Tim Crotts is making his way this direction. We're going to get right into the next preacher, Brother Dowdy. Brother Crotts will be our last preacher. These preachers have stayed right on time tonight, and so that is not their fault. Although I think Brother Jordan could have ended sooner had he not given us a karate demonstration up here. Brother Crotts, it's 5 after, and you're our last preacher of the meeting. You just monitor the crowd, and when they fall asleep, it means it's time to go. So the sooner you fake sleep,
we won't have to fake it. Bumpy.
You can be seated. You can be seated. I got to spend some time with Brother Crotts this, when was it? A couple weeks ago?
A couple weeks ago.
Yeah, not long ago.
Three.
Preached down there at his missions conference. And Brother Crotts is a dear friend. We've only known each other for 5 or 6 years, maybe 7 years. I don't know. He's a dear friend, and he's not preached one message where I've not walked away having not been helped, I mean. He's been such a help to me so many times. I learned something about just a really, really interesting story. When we were down there a few weeks ago, his father passed away that week, and his father had been a pastor. How long had he been a pastor of that church?
30-some years.
30-some years. And he was telling me a little bit about it, and I've told several people this story, Brother Crotts. His dad got saved when he was 19 years old and just got faithful in church. The Lord sent someone to disciple him and started doing anything he could around the church, got busy doing maintenance and cleaning and all that stuff. A little while later, started teaching and doing some other things in the church. Eventually found himself as the assistant pastor, and one day became the pastor of that church. When he passed away, that was the only church he had ever attended.
Right.
Isn't that something? From the time he was saved until the Lord called him home, one church. His mom is over here this evening, Brother Crotts. His mom's over here somewhere.
Yes.
Came with him to the meeting this week. Thank you so much for coming. We Sure do appreciate it. Brother Crotts, you know where you're at tonight. Praise so you make yourself at home, okay?
Thank
I love you.
So much, preacher. Love you too. Praise the Lord. It sure is a blessing to be here. Thank you, Brother Adam, Faith Baptist Church. You guys are a tremendous blessing to me. One of the preachers said earlier this week how envious he is of this place, and I echo that. Everything here is always top-notch, and I'm so thankful you allow us to come and be a part of the meeting. It's good to have my wife with me this week, and also two of my grandbabies. My mom's with me, and so we've had a good week, brother. I appreciate you, the accommodations, taking care of us, being so good to us, treating us just like family. We thank you for that. It's been a blessing. I want to be a help to you tonight. I certainly have enjoyed all of the preaching this week. It's been a tremendous blessing. I was telling the pastor last night, I've received help from the preaching. I've enjoyed the singing. I love missionaries and missionary work, and I appreciate all the missionaries and all the missionary presentations and all of that this week. It's been a great blessing, and we're thankful to be here this evening. If you find your place in Acts chapter 26, I thought I knew exactly what I was going to preach several weeks ago, and then it seemed that the Lord had changed my mind, and now I'm back to that original thought. I do hope the Lord will help us this evening. I want to be a blessing to you. Acts chapter 26, I am resisting the urge to tell a couple of jokes. You may be asleep, and I might need to wake you up, but I'm not much of a joke teller. I'll leave that to Brother Jordan. He does a great job of doing that. He don't have to tell jokes, amen. He's just entertaining. He's funny. I enjoyed that a great deal. I've enjoyed all the preaching. Brother Powers is my dear friend. And if you didn't hear the last sermon he preached this morning, you need to back up and listen to that. Amen. It blessed my heart, him preaching this morning. I love Brother Powers, dear friend of mine. Acts chapter 26, here's what I want to do this evening with the help of the Lord. I'm going to read just four words of the beginning of a verse. And I want you to hold your place in your Bible. I'm going to look at several places in the book of Acts. I'm not going to ask you to turn anywhere else. I'm going to mention some things from other places in the scripture, but I want you to hold your place in the book of Acts. We're going to look at several things. I'm going to try to move quickly. I want to do a Bible study primarily quickly, and it'll take me longer to get the introduction of the sermon done than it will the message. I just have very quick four points after I get some introductory stuff done, and I hope the Lord will help us. Acts chapter 26, look at verse number 2. I'm just going to read the first four words. Paul is the one doing the speaking, and he said, I think myself happy. I think myself happy. Amen. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for the Bible. Thank you for the opportunity, Lord, that we've had to be here this week. Only eternity will tell how you've helped my heart this week in the meeting. I thank you for all the preaching, the fellowship. It's been a tremendous blessing. Lord, I realize that the people are tired. They're weary. It's been many services, many preachers, way too much food, desserts, and all those things that we indulge in. It's been a tremendous blessing. Lord, I pray that you would help me to keep their attention for just a few moments, not that they would hear from me. That would be worthless. But Lord, that they would hear something from the Bible, and that you would use me to say something that would be a help to them, either currently in their lives or somewhere in the future when they need this. And then, Lord, as one of the brethren mentioned, maybe even tonight, Lord, I need to take heed to my own preaching. Lord, I need your help, and I pray you would help me. I thank you for that, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. King James Bible contains approximately 780,000 words. The New Testament, 160,000 of those words make up our New Testament. Of all of those words in the Bible, the word happy is only found 28 times in 25 verses. 19 of those times is in the Old Testament, and only 6 times is the word happy found in the New Testament. The only time in the book of Acts that the word happy is used is in our text in Acts chapter 26 and verse number 2. The word happy has many definitions, and it can be used in many different ways. From what I understand, the word happiness comes about by events or activities that make us happy. In other words, happiness comes about by or do what about or due to what is happening in our lives. This can somewhat be proved from Scripture as well. I mentioned just a moment ago, I was going to mention a couple of things, but I don't want you to turn there. The first time the word happy is mentioned in the Bible, it's in Genesis chapter 30, and it has to do with the birth of a child. In Genesis chapter 30 and verse number 12, the Bible says, "And Zelphi, Leah's maid, bare Jacob a second son, and Leah said, 'Happy am I, for the daughters will call me blessed,' and she called his name Asher." Now, this is the first time the word happy is mentioned in the Bible. Leah is happy because of what is happening, but for the wrong reason. Now, this is not my sermon. She's not happy that a child's being born. She's happy because of what others are going to think of her because the child is being born. Now, this is a great spiritual application, a good place to make a spiritual application. Sometimes we are more concerned about what our peers think about us than we are children being born. She's happy because of something that is taking place or because of something that is happening. In Psalms 127 in verse number 5, the Bible says, "Happy is the man that hath his quiver full of them," speaking of children. The Bible says, "Happy is that people whose God is the Lord. Happy is he that hath the God of Jacob for his help. Happy is the man that findeth wisdom. But he that hath mercy on the poor, happy is he. And whoso trusteth in the Lord, happy is he. Where there is no vision, the people perish. But he that keepeth the law, happy is he." Amen. Jesus himself only used the word happy one time in his earthly ministry, and that was in John 13 and verse number 17, where Jesus said, if you know these things, happy are ye if you do them. In that context, he is talking about washing his brother's feet. Now, I'll say this, I'll just try to sum up that just quickly. It's the fact that he is showing humility. If I could paraphrase, I would say, happy is the man that will put others before himself. Peter uses the word happy twice in chapter 3 and verse 14. He says, "But and if you suffer for righteousness' sake, happy are ye." He said again, "If you be reproached for the name of Christ, happy are ye." I use these few verses just for examples to show you from the Bible that happy or happiness comes about by events or things that are happening that make us happy. Now, I want to give you some background information concerning the brief portion of Scripture that I've read thus far in Acts chapter 26 and verse number 2, where Paul made the statement, "I think myself happy," and then I'll give you four reasons from our text why we should think ourselves happy. Paul here is made this statement, but leading up to this place in Scripture, Paul had a desire within himself to go to Jerusalem. I want you to come all the way back to Acts chapter 18, and we're going to look at a few things quickly. I'm going to move quickly. The Bible says in Acts chapter number 18 and verse 21, Paul is nearing the very end of his second missionary journey. And look what he says in Acts 18 verse 21. The Bible said, "But bade them farewell," speaking of the Ephesians, "he bade them farewell and said, 'I must by all means.'" Now, before we finish reading this text, I want you to think about this. Paul is about to make a statement that he needs to go to Jerusalem. And he said before he made that statement, "I must by all means." Now, I want you to think about this for just a moment. Paul is saying this, "By whatever means necessary or whatever it takes, I have got to get back to Jerusalem." Can I just say something briefly? If we have our mindset on that and it's not according to what God wants us to do, we're going to find ourselves in big trouble. Paul said, "I must by all means, by whatever means necessary, keep this feast that cometh to Jerusalem, but I will return again unto you if God will." And he sailed from Ephesus. So Paul here, in this text of Scripture, he had a burning desire to get back to Jerusalem. Now I want you to come to chapter 19. In chapter 19 of the book of Acts, Paul returns to Ephesus on his third missionary journey. And notice what the Bible says in Acts 19 and verse 21. The Bible says in Acts 19, verse 21, I love to hear those pages turning, as Brother Adam made mention of, and I'm going to wait for him to turn tonight because I want you to see that what I'm saying is from the Bible and not from me. Look what the Bible says in Acts 19, verse 21. After these things are ended, Paul purposed in the Spirit. Now, time out. Hold on 1 second. I understand how important it is to study words in the Bible, but I think it's also important that we pay attention to letters in the Bible. If you notice in the scripture here, this Spirit is not capitalized. It is a small s. Paul is determining something within his own spirit and not within the Holy Spirit. Look at it in the Bible. He's after these things were ended, Paul purposed in the Spirit when he had passed through Macedonia and Achaia to go to Jerusalem, saying, after I have been there, I must also see Rome. Now, we learn from this verse that Paul has purposed within himself in his own spirit to return to Jerusalem. Now come to Acts chapter 20. Acts chapter 20, if you will, and verse 16. Look what the Bible says. Acts chapter 20, verse 16. The Bible says, for Paul had determined to sail by Ephesus because he would not spend the time in Asia. Notice why. For he hasted, if it were possible for him, to be at Jerusalem the day of Pentecost. So Paul is rushing past, or Paul is rushing through Asia, if you will, because he wanted to get back to Jerusalem. Now I want to say a couple of things quickly. Paul's reason for desiring to go to Jerusalem was right. He wanted to go there because he loved the Jews. He loved the people. In fact, the Bible says in Romans chapter 9, verse number 1, Paul said, I say the truth in Christ. I lie not. My conscience also bear me witness in the Holy Ghost that I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart. For I could wish myself accursed from Christ for my brethren, my kinsmen according to the flesh, who are Israelites. There's no way you can read that passage of Scripture and not see clearly that Paul's burden for these people at Jerusalem, his reason for wanting to go there was the right reason. He loved the people. His reason for wanting to go there was right. His motive for wanting to go there was right. I believe Paul's motive for going to Jerusalem was right. He wanted to go there because he wanted to see them saved. The Bible says in Romans 10 and verse number 1, Paul said, brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. His reason for going was right. His motive for going was right. He didn't desire to go there that he might gain some kind of following. He didn't desire to go there or that he might gain some kind of earthly possession or some kind of position in life. No, he wanted to go there because he wanted those people to be saved. His reason for going was right. His motive for going was right. He wanted with all of his heart and with all of his might to go there. However, the Lord told the Apostle Paul on numerous occasions not to go back to Jerusalem. Now, I want to show you from the Bible 4 times where the Bible is very specific and very clear about the Apostle Paul not making a return trip to Jerusalem. Look at Acts chapter 20, verse 22. Acts chapter 20, verse 22. And now behold, I go bound in the Spirit. Notice that small s again. This is Paul's spirit, not the Holy Spirit. Can I just say quickly that oftentimes my will gets in the way of God's will. And if you're not careful, there's going to be times in your life when your will gets in the way of God's will. And so Paul says here in the writing, I go bound in the Spirit unto Jerusalem. Now look what he says.
not knowing the things that shall befall me there. And then, but he does know. Because verse 23 says, save that the Holy Ghost witnesseth in every city, saying that bonds and afflictions abide me. Paul was warned by the Holy Ghost in every city. Now, we have this recorded warning that I'm going to mention in the Bible four times, but we're not exactly sure how many times God warned him, because in every city that Paul went to with his determination to go to Jerusalem, the Holy Spirit witnessed, the Bible said, in every city that bonds and afflictions awaited him if he went there. Now come to Acts chapter 21. Acts 21. And look at verse number 3. Acts 21 and verse number 3. Now when we had discovered Cyprus, we left it on the left hand and sailed into Syria and landed at Tyre, for there the ship was to unlade her burden. And finding disciples, we tarried there 7 days, who said to Paul through the Spirit. Notice the capital? Yes, sir. The Holy Spirit. Look what the Holy Spirit said. It's not hard to understand. Say it with me. That he should not go up to Jerusalem. Paul spent 7 days, the Bible tells us here, in Tyre. The Bible says in verse number 4, finding disciples, plural. I don't know how many that is, but I know it's more than one. And so more than one disciple for 7 days told the Apostle Paul that not to go to Jerusalem. And they weren't telling them that of their own volition. They were telling them that according to the Bible, through the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now come to verse number 10, same chapter. Acts 21, verse 10, same chapter. Paul was warned again at Caesarea. Verse number 10, he says, And as we tarried there many days, there came down from Judea a certain prophet named Agabus. Now I know that this guy doesn't get a lot of recognition, but God is going to use him to warn the Apostle Paul. Verse number 11 says, and when he was coming to us, he took Paul's girdle. That's a waistband type of garment. We'll talk about it in just a moment. And bound his hands and bound his own hands and feet, and said, thus saith the what? Say it with me. Holy Ghost. In case you missed the capital S Spirit in verse number 3, verse number 10 makes it clear that the Holy Spirit's the one giving the warning. Thus saith the Holy Ghost, so shall the Jews at Jerusalem bind the man that owneth this girdle, and shall deliver him into the hands of the Gentiles. And when we heard these things, now look at this, both we and they of that place besought him, look what it says again, not to go up to Jerusalem. Paul uses this prophet Agabus. He comes down to Tyre, Caesarea, and he takes Paul's garment, his waistband off. He'll call it a belt for the sake of description or example, something you can understand. He takes his belt off and he ties his hand together and he ties his feet together, and he says, whoever this garment belongs to, if he goes to Jerusalem, he's going to be bound hand and feet. And then the Bible says both we and they. So we know Luke is the writer, the human penman of the book of Acts. So we know that Luke and Paul's entourage, Paul's traveling buddies, I can tell you who I think those are, but it doesn't matter. It was more than one man. They told the Apostle Paul, they besought, they begged, they pleaded with the Apostle Paul not to go up to Jerusalem, because if they did, they would. Paul was going to be bound hand and foot. Now, in spite of all those warnings, look at verse 17, Acts chapter 21. And when we were come to Jerusalem, the brethren received us gladly. You see that, Acts 21, verse 17. In spite of all the warnings, Paul goes to Jerusalem. Now, here, this has nothing to do with the message, but it'll help you. The people at Jerusalem are excited to see the Apostle Paul. I tell you something, if I'd have been living in that day and I had an opportunity to see the Apostle Paul, I'd have been excited as well. I'd have been thrilled to death he was there. But there's something hidden here that's a good help to you and I. Just because the brethren are happy about your decision doesn't mean God is. He's been warned repeatedly not to go to Jerusalem, but where's he at? He's in Jerusalem. And the brethren are happy that here he's there. I'm all for counsel. I think we ought to get counsel. I think we ought to seek people's opinion. I think all of those things are good. The Bible makes mention of that. I want to tell you something. It doesn't matter how many people approve of what you're doing. If God doesn't approve of it, it's not going to end well. Now, here's a fourth time, and then I'm going to get to the message. Now, before chapter 21 is ended, and we're going to go back and look at it in a minute, Paul is arrested. So in chapter 22, we see something that we do not know took place until after Paul was arrested. He tells us about it in chapter 22. I want to read it to you. Look what the Bible says in verse 17, Acts chapter 21. Now, in Acts chapter 22, Paul has already been arrested. He's already in Jerusalem. He's testifying before the chief captain. He's testifying before the mob that wants to kill him. And look what he says in verse 17. And it came to pass that when I was come again to Jerusalem. So Paul's talking about being in Jerusalem right now, where we already know he's not supposed to be. Now look what he said. Even while I prayed in the temple, I was in a trance and saw him saying unto me. Now, if you have a Bible that has the words of Christ in red, you can see that he's speaking of the Lord that's going to be talking to him. But if you don't have a Bible with the words of Christ in red, it doesn't matter. Verse 19 is going to tell us plainly who it is. And he said, I was in a trance and I saw him saying unto me, now look, make haste and get thee quickly out of Jerusalem, for they will not receive thy testimony concerning me. Now, I got to elaborate on this for just a minute. Can I just say something that will sound a lot like Brother Jordan? Wow! Paul has went to Jerusalem completely against God's will. He's done the same thing that he has done every time he's entered a city. He went to the temple to pray. And while he is in the temple praying, the Lord, what a merciful God, get out of Jerusalem.
Amen.
Make haste and get out of Jerusalem. They're not going to hear you. Now, look, let's keep reading. Keep reading. Verse 19. And I said, ain't that, don't you like, the Lord said, but I said.
Yeah, come on.
Don't be critical, Apostle Paul, because you do it all the time. The Lord said, make haste and get out of here. And Paul said, and I said, verse 19, Lord, they know that I imprisoned and beat in every synagogue them that believed on thee. And when the blood of thy martyr Stephen was shed, I also was standing by and consenting unto his death and kept the raiment of them that slew him. Now look, the Lord's going to speak again. And he said unto me, depart! And get thee far hence to the Gentiles. So Paul did the same thing that we have tried to do on numerous occasions. He tried to argue and to reason with God when he already had clear and specific direction from God concerning what to do. And he wanted to say, no, you're wrong, Lord. Look, this will work. God said, make haste and get out. And then he said, depart. I mean, look at it in your Bible. Depart, colon. That's it. That's the sentence that's finished. Depart. Make haste. Get out of here. Our God is merciful. Our God is gracious. Our God is wonderful. And we have just learned that as great and wonderful as the Apostle Paul is, he and I have something in common that neither one of us like. We're stubborn and oftentimes disobedient. God has told him to leave. He didn't leave. Now look, listen. Before Paul, I'm going to show you in Scripture. I want you to see it. Before Paul leaves the temple, he never gets out of the temple before he is beaten and arrested. Look what the Bible says. Look at chapter 21. What we just read in chapter 22 was Paul testifying about events that occurred prior to his arrest. Paul arrives back in Jerusalem in chapter 21, but before the chapter's over, the mob tries to kill him. Look what the Bible says in verse number 30, Acts 21. The Bible says in Acts 21, verse 30, and all the city was moved, and the people ran together, and they took Paul. Now, don't miss this next phrase in your Bible, and drew him out of the temple. And forthwith the doors were shut, and as they went about to kill him, tidings came to the chief captain of the band that all Jerusalem was in an uproar, who immediately took soldiers and centurions and ran down into them. And when they saw the chief captain and the soldiers, they left beating of Paul. Now again, we see the mercy of God in Paul's life. Paul is in the temple praying. We read that in chapter 22. The Lord spoke to him twice, told him to get out of Jerusalem. He did not leave. When he left the temple, he left being let out and beaten by a mob. They drug him out of the temple. God is so merciful. Instead of allowing him to be beat to death by that mob, the Lord rescues him, has the chief captain to come with his soldiers and rescue him out from underneath that mob that wants to kill him. What a merciful God. Now, you're sitting there looking at me like a calf at a new gate. You ought to be praising the Lord because he's had that same mercy on you numerous times. He's been merciful to you and I so many times in this same fashion. Paul is arrested in verse 33. And he'll never again be a free man. Look what the Bible says. Now listen, here's why that's important. There will not be a fourth missionary journey by the Apostle Paul. The last thing Jesus said to him was, depart, I will send you far hence to the Gentiles. Now listen, I'm not going to argue with you. I'm not going to fuss with you. I don't think the Lord was finished with the Apostle Paul establishing churches around the globe. See how quiet it is, brother? I believe I can prove it from the Bible that that's what God intended for him to continue doing, but he disobeyed. Amen. And he wound up in prison. Just like, look at verse 33. Look what the Bible says. Then the chief captain came near and took him and commanded him. Now don't miss this. To be bound with two chains and demanded who he was and what he had done. You remember what the prophet Agabus said earlier in the same chapter, that if you go to Jerusalem, you're going to be bound. Here he is in verse number 32, just like the prophet warned, he's bound. Now look, I'm moving quickly. I told that's the foundation. It'll take me just a minute to preach my sermon. I'll be done. In Acts chapter 22, that was Acts 21. In Acts 22, Paul is allowed to testify before the chief captain and the mob that tried to kill him. We talked about that. In Acts chapter 23, Paul is permitted to speak before the Sanhedrin. In Acts chapter 24, he stands before the governor, Felix. Felix trembled and said, I will call you when I have a convenient season. We have no evidence that he ever had a convenient season. So if you're here tonight and you're not saved and the Lord has spoken to your heart sometime during this meeting, today is the day of salvation and now is accepted time. 2 years later, in Acts chapter 25, Paul stands before the new governor, Festus. When we get to our text in Acts chapter 26, where I read the four little words that I read just a moment ago, Paul has been in prison for a little over 2 years now. And he has an opportunity to stand before King Agrippa and testify. Yeah. And Paul begins his conversation with King Agrippa with these four words. Amen. He said, I think myself happy. Now here's what I want you to see, and I'll be finished. Paul did not start his conversation with King Agrippa by complaining about being falsely arrested. He didn't start his conversation with King Agrippa about being unjustly beaten. He didn't waste his time speaking to King Agrippa about the conditions of the prison. He offered no argument to appeal his sentence. He didn't talk about how disgusting the food was and how deplorable the conditions were. He didn't waste any of his time in doing any of that. He didn't complain about any of the ruthless inmates or none of the crazy people that were in the prison. In spite of all that's going on in the Apostle Paul's life, he begins his conversation with, I think myself happy. Here's my sermon, 4 points, and I'm done. Number one, it is possible to be happy again in spite of disobedience. I do not recommend disobedience. I don't condone disobedience, and God knows I've been whooped too many times for being disobedient. But sometimes in our life, when we are disobedient to God, we allow the enemy in our flesh to beat us down to where we're no good for God anymore. But in spite of all that, Paul's not just disobedient. Can I listen? I would say nothing about the Apostle Paul that the Bible doesn't say about him. I have the utmost respect for this man, but he was not just disobedient. Careful, listen. He was willfully disobedient. Now listen, if the Apostle Paul, most likely the majority of us in here, is Bible hero. Besides the Lord Jesus Christ, He has had more influence on my life than anybody I know. The writings in the New Testament by the Apostle Paul, they're life-changing. So if the Apostle Paul has not just been disobedient, but willfully disobedient, I would dare say that everybody in this building has been disobedient, or you are currently involved in disobedience, or you will soon make a decision that will be willfully disobedient to God. When that happens, the enemy is going to do everything that it possibly can to put you out of business when it comes to doing anything for God. But can I tell you that in spite of all of that, our great God and our wonderful God, who continually tried to even get him out of that situation after he got himself in it, he wants to help you. And he wants you to continue serving him. Number one, you can be happy in spite of disobedience. Number two, you can be happy in spite of your environment. Paul is in prison. And in spite of the fact that Paul's in prison, he's happy. Paul is standing there in chains. He's the only one in the crowd that is bound, and he's the only one that is happy. Yeah. I am thankful that God can give us the ability to be happy in spite of our surroundings and our environment and our circumstances and our condition. Now listen, I'm trying to hurry. I know, but I'm trying. You may never have to go to prison physically. I hope you never do. I hope I never have to. But there's many of you in this room tonight, you're in prison. There are many of you who are imprisoned to a health condition that has no cure. I don't know
any of that. I just know how it is. Or some of you who are in prison, or you know someone with a medical condition that aside from the Lord having mercy upon them and taking them home, there's no relief from that prison. There's never going to be a time when there's going to be parole. You're not going to be going up for parole. It's never going to be over this side of eternity. Do you have enough of God to be happy in that prison? Some of you are in prison to a family situation. There's children, or there's spouses, or there's extended family. And I, Brother Adam, you know this as well as I do, the worst thing in our lives or in ministry is situations we have no control over. There are things that take place and things that happen in all of our lives. The things that torment me the most is I can't fix it. I can't do anything about it. I can't change it. I can't make it right. There's nothing I can do. With God's help, inside of that prison, I can still be happy in the Lord anyway. You can be happy in spite of disobedience. You can be happy in spite of prison. Number three, you can be happier than the elite. In this chapter, I can't remember if it's Felix or Festus. I get confused. The new governor, Felix. He's not happy. He said, Paul, much learning has made you mad. I'll put that in Cana, Virginia vernacular from where I've come. Paul, shut up. I don't want to hear it no more. Yeah. He's not happy. King Agrippa said, almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian. He's in a valley of decision. And all of you women know that when your husband is in a valley of decision, nobody's happy. Bernice, depending on who you believe, she's either his sister that he's involved in a pathetic relationship with, or it's his wife. She's not happy. She gets up from the meeting and she just walks out and goes on. She may be related to the king, but she's not happy. Yeah. Worldly pomp and circumstance and position will not make you happy. Right. You can be the king. You can be the governor. You can be related to those in the upper echelon, but without Jesus, you'll never be happy. Paul said, I think myself happy. Number four, and I'm done. You should always be happy, and this is in the context of verse number two, when you have an opportunity to speak for Jesus. Paul didn't waste his time talking about what had went on in his life. He didn't waste his time talking about all the problems and the conditions that were going on in the prison. He said, I want to tell you something, King. I met a man one day on the road to Damascus. And in spite of all that's went on in my life, listen carefully. I'm not blaming everybody else. In spite of all the problems that I created, I stand before you today thinking myself happy. Now, I'm done. I got to quit. Job says happy. The book of Job, he talks about the man being happy whom the Lord chasteneth. If God chastens you because of your disobedience, you ought to be happy. There's a whole nother sermon, and obviously, come on, Brother Adam, I'm done. Obviously, no time to preach the sermon at all. There's a whole nother sermon, and it has to do with the word think. I think. Paul didn't say he was happy. He said, I think myself happy. Your emotions depend on your thinking process. The majority of our emotional problems and our spiritual problems comes because we're not thinking on the right thing. Amen. Amen. God bless you, preacher.
Let's stand together, please. I was trying to count a while ago. I was going back over my notes from the week, and I think there was six messages that had something to do with waiting on the Lord, following the Lord, seeking the Lord. And I think there's a good chance that there's people here tonight who needed to be told to just be patient and wait on the Lord. Just be obedient to the Lord. Would you bow your heads and stand quietly where you are? The altar's open this evening. Some have already come. If the Lord has spoken to your heart this evening, I would invite you to respond. What a good exhortation from Brother Jordan about just talking to somebody about what the Lord's done for you. Telling somebody what he's done for you. Brother Williams spoke about waiting on the Lord, being content and patient as you wait. And Brother Crotts, I think myself happy. Becca, play something softly on the piano, please. Brother Dowdy, sing that first verse, would you?
My life, my love, I give to thee, thou Lamb of God who died for me. Oh, may I ever faithful be, my Savior and my God. I'll live for him who died for me. How happy then my life shall be. I'll live for him who died for me, my Savior and my God.
Page 493 in your hymn book. Page 493. We'll sing a couple of verses together. There's time for you to respond to what the Lord has done in your heart. It's impossible to sit through the number of messages we've sat through this week and not have been dealt with in some way. Don't miss an opportunity to respond this evening. If you're here tonight and you don't truly know the Lord Jesus Christ as the Savior of your soul, you could leave this place tonight having come in with doubts and fears about eternity. You can leave this place tonight with it completely settled and being eternally secure. Can have that tonight. Let's sing that first verse together. You come as we sing.
My life, my love, I give to thee, thou Lamb of God who died for me. Oh, may I ever faithful be, my Savior and my God. I'll live for him who died for me. How happy then my life shall be. I'll live for him who died for me, my Savior and my God. I now believe thou didst receive, for thou hast died that I might live. And now henceforth I'll trust in thee, my Savior and my God.
Sing it together now.
I'll live for him who died for me. How happy then my life shall be. I'll live for him who died for me, my Savior and my God.
Just bow your heads, please, and sing quietly there just for a moment. We'll play through one more verse. Young people, you young adults, you teenagers, you are just, at any given time, you're just one decision away from stepping out of God's will for your life and into what could lead down a long road that you'll never return from. I would just beg you, be patient. Just be patient. Don't move till the Lord says move. When he says move, be willing to go. Just be patient. Father, thank you for this week. Lord, I am so grateful for all you've done for us. And God, as we conclude this invitation, I pray that you would help us as we leave to remember the things we've heard tonight and all this week, and we'll thank you for it, Father. And God, would you bless the food and the fellowship as we leave this place? Well, thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Just a couple of quick announcements before we're dismissed. There is some more food downstairs. It seems like I've announced that as much as anything this week. There's some stuff downstairs. Go downstairs and enjoy a little bit before you leave. And Brother Boggs said that if you're a veteran in this place, he wants you to have a free Bible. It's on his table back there. You can see Brother Boggs about that. He'll be leaving early in the morning. I think you said 2 a.m. You're planning to get on the road and head south to Winston-Salem. So get by and see that. And then let me just say to Faith Baptist, I started to have everybody come up here that helped, and I don't think that would come across right. And I just want to say thank you to Faith Baptist. It's been a joy, and I've done so little work around here. I've done more talking with preachers than I have anything. So thank you for all your hard work, Faith. It's been a good meeting, and we couldn't have done it without the help. So thank you so much. All of you folks, please know that we love you. We sure do appreciate you. We're going to change things up a little bit next year. We're actually going to move the dates back just a little bit to try to accommodate some other stuff. We'll send out those letters. If you don't get our letters, several people told me they did not receive letters about the meetings, the reminders. If you don't get those letters, text me and let me know. Text me the right address, and we'll make sure we try to get you on the list to give you the dates and all of that, okay? I think that's all of the announcements. The offering this evening, it came to enough to be able to give all of the missionaries $375, and we're going to up that to $400, and so missionaries, don't leave before you get those checks. If you're one of the missionaries that were here with us all week, we want to make sure that you get those, okay? Well, it's been a good meeting. Thank you for being here. I sure have enjoyed it. Brother Dowdy, would you come and just close us in prayer? I sure appreciate you being here, Brother Dowdy. I know it takes effort to get here, but we sure do appreciate it. I love you.
Let's pray. Lord, we thank you so much for this day. Thank you, Lord, for the messages we heard this evening and throughout this week, Lord, and the challenge they are to our hearts. Lord, I pray that everyone that was here tonight, Lord, be able to leave this place and Lord, it's a little bit different than what we were when we came. And Lord, I pray it'd be help to our lives. And Lord, just thank you for what you do. I thank you, Lord, that you have a Holy Spirit that still works in our lives. And Lord, I pray you'd continue to bless each and every one. Be with those, Lord, that are leaving and traveling many miles. Lord, I pray you give them safety as they travel. And Lord, bring us back safely to our various places. We just thank you for all that you do. Lord, I pray continue to bless our lives. We pray this all in your name. Amen.